regular meeting of the Planning Commission dated December 15, 2021. We are conducting this meeting by way of WebEx teleconference call. And due to the state of emergency declared due to the COVID-19 virus, Planning Commission regular meeting will be conducted via WebEx conference. Calls to this number can be on our WebEx at 1-415-655-0001 with an access code of 2345-816-8678. And with that, I would call this meeting to order. In fact, what I will not do is call this meeting to order and defer to our president, Mr. Griffin.
Thank you. Sorry I was late. Had no audio for a second there. Hopefully I have audio now.
Which you do, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry, where are we at in the, we need a motion to approve the agenda?
Pledge of Allegiance, sir.
Oh, okay. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. May we have a roll call, please?
Yes, sir. Mr. Culpepper.
Here.
Mr. Huntington.
Present.
Mr. Martin. Does not look like he's on yet. We did hear that he might be a little bit late this afternoon.
That's good.
Ms. Mee is excused. Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Present.
Mr. Willis.
Here.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Here.
All right. Mr. Chairman, you do have a quorum to conduct business this evening.
Thank you. Now, looking for the motion to approve the agenda.
This is Commissioner Rob Willis. I would move for approval of the agenda dated this date, December 15th, 2021.
Support, Commissioner Huntington.
Okay, favorable motion by Commissioner Willis, supported by Commissioner Huntington. Can we run through the roll call vote on that, please?
Yes, sir. Mr. Culpepper.
Yes.
Mr. Huntington.
Support.
Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Yes.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
All right, Mr. Chairman, you have an approval for your agenda this evening.
Okay, do we have any announcements or communications?
I don't have any at this time, sir.
Great. Moving right on to the public hearings then. First one is PSLU 21-0009.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So your first public hearing this evening is a special use request of Eagle Alliance Wings, LLC, on behalf of the owner, Northwestern Highway Plaza, LLC. The unit address that we're looking at this evening is 28595 Northwestern Highway. We are on the south side of Northwestern Highway between Franklin and Beck. Civil parcel 24182760039. Existing zoning of the property is B1 neighborhood business, and the special use request is to allow for the tenant to have a restaurant with a bar. This is a closer look of the property itself. This is one of our newer shopping centers within the city of Southfield on Northwestern Highway. The particular unit in question is on the west side of this particular property in this particular shopping center. So again, this is the front of the shopping center looking for Northwestern Highway. The unit is what is currently labeled as Leo's Coney Island. In this case, the petitioner is looking to put in a Debo's Wings location in this particular property. As I noted, property is owned B1, neighborhood business, and regional mixed use for future land use. This is the details in the floor plan of the property. You can see that at least on the northern or on the upper portion of the slide that you can see for the unit, shows the layout of existing of the proposed tables, as well as the bar that would be directly in the middle of that space. The kind of the south portion or the lower half of the unit would be where the kitchen, walk-in freezers, dishwashing, and so on is located. On the left hand of the slide, you can see some sketches of the potential for what the interior of the space would look like. With that, we do have the petitioner on this evening. So if you would like to explain your project further, now is your time to do that. I believe, Ron, you're on this evening.
Okay, thank you. Yes, we, as described, we're converting the Leo's Coney Island to a Debo's Wings franchise. We will be one of the first franchises outside of their original location, which was Memphis, Tennessee. They'll be bringing this franchise to multiple cities around, starting with Chicago, Atlanta, as well as a couple of locations in Florida. So we will be the flagship location in Michigan. And then we're hoping to help them open up a couple of other locations around the area, as well as Grand Rapids and the Lansing area. So this project, we require the special use because we're also going to have daiquiris within their product mix, which of course requires the liquor license. So we're going through that process now and applying for the liquor license. We've gone far with the state right now. They've issued a conditional license. So we're just now going through the steps with the city for those final approvals.
So Ron, can you, just before we head into other items here, number of employees and hours of operation?
We're looking at a total number of employees hovering around 26. And our hours of operation are going to go from 11 to 2 o'clock.
That's 2 a.m., right?
Sure. Yes. Yep.
Okay.
Okay. And could you just state your name and address for the record? It should have got that at the beginning.
Sure. Yep. It's let me give my government name. Apologize for the middle name there that I go by. It's Creflo, C-R-E, F as in Frank, L-O, last name Mims, M-I, M as in Mary, S. And I'm at 30104 Sparkleberry Drive, and that's Southfield, 48076.
Okay, thank you.
I get teased about that street name all the time, so.
Nice. All right. Anything further on your presentation?
No, that's it.
Okay. Thank you. This is a public hearing. We'll open up the public hearing at this time.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So for those who are either watching online or listening, now is your opportunity to make a public comment on this particular special land use. Again, the item before the Planning Commission this evening is whether or not this particular location should be allowed to have a bar in it. So that is the item before the Planning Commission tonight. If you do have a question or a comment to make, the number to call in and the code is currently on the screen. Dial 1-415-655-0001. Then when prompted, add the code 23458168678. There is a little bit of a delay between this live version of the Planning Commission versus what's currently online. So Mr. Chairman, we'll sign off here for about a minute or so. We'll see if anyone calls in with any questions or comments, and I will be back with you shortly. Hey, Mr. Chairman, it's been about a minute or so. I do have a couple of people on the attendee list, so I'm going to open up and unmute, see if you have a comment with regard to special land use, PSLU 21-0009. Now is your opportunity to make your public comment. Mr. Chairman, it does not appear that we have anyone from the public to speak on this item this evening.
Okay, I'll close the public hearing now and open up to the commission for any questions or comments.
Mr. Chair, this is Commissioner Culpepper.
Yes.
A few questions for Ron. Ron, you gave the hours of operation, but what's your days? 5 days a week, 7 days a week? What does that look like?
We're taking that 7 days a week. And as the market determines whether we're going to keep at that pace, you know, we'll determine it then. But
okay. Yeah, it's always good to ask for the seven. If you don't need it, you don't have to use it, but then you have to come back. Okay, second question. As we talked about in our last meeting, you know that the City of Sofia has no liquor license available, and you said you was going through the process now to get approved for the liquor license. What if you don't get approval to get the liquor license? Will you still open and operate?
Yes, we kind of have. We do have a fallback plan. We'll basically convert it almost to a Wingstop type of operation with just no alcohol component. And we also spoke with the landlord that maybe we don't need the entire space. So we've got a contingency plan. Hopefully we won't have to go through that plan, but we do have a contingency.
All right. Well, great. I too agree and hope that you don't have to go to plan B, because as we stated numerous times, people do want those to drink, do want to go out and eat and have some type of beverage other than pop in that water. So again, I think this is great. I think it fits the use. It's a good location, excellent location. So I wish you a lot of luck. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you.
This is Geraldine Stevens-Gunn to the Chair.
Commissioner Stevens-Gunn first, please, and then Commissioner Huntington.
Mr. Mims, I'm very impressed with the project. I just have one quick question. What is your maximum occupancy once you open?
Right now, we have an occupancy of 90 people.
Okay. Was that it, Commissioner Stevens-Gunn?
Yeah, that was it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Huntington?
Okay, a couple of questions. One, as far as security, let's assume that you do get the liquor license and it's a full-fledged bar there. Is there any plans for any type of security to be around, or just the normal employees?
Again, we would be in a situation that we would definitely flex in terms of bringing in security if necessary. We're hoping not to get that type of crowd, and by being a restaurant, we don't anticipate on needing to necessarily card everyone, but we may need to card folks after certain hours of operation, things like that. So we definitely have a security team or a security company that we have, that, you know, that are already kind of bid on this project if necessary. So definitely will have security if needed.
Okay, another question. Are you selling solely wings, or is it more of a fuller menu than that?
We're hope you've eaten already, because once I tell you the menu, you're gonna get real hungry. So
okay.
So we got the wings. We have the seafood boil, so you can get the crab legs and the things like that. We also have hamburgers as well. So we'll have the hamburgers, chicken sandwiches, boiled seafood, and wings as part of our mix.
Yeah, you're right. I am hungry now. Okay. All right. Thanks a lot. Good luck to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other, Commissioner Willis, anything to add?
No, other than I can say I am fully in favor of it. I'm in fact, I'm looking forward to some wings and seafood.
Okay. Yep, I'm in full support of this project as well. Good location. Sounds like an interesting concept. I wish you luck. Can we have a recommendation from the planning department, please?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So the planning department this evening recommends favorable recommendation of the special use request of Eagle Alliance Wings LLC on behalf of the owner Northwestern Highway Plaza LLC to allow for a tenant space to be used as a restaurant with bar. Property located 28595 Northwestern Highway, suitable parcel 24182760 39. On the south side of Northwestern Highway between Franklin and Beck, for the following reasons and conditions. Hours of operation shall be limited to 11 a.m. to 2 a.m. Monday through Sunday. Submitted special use with any conditions recommended by the Planning Department and Planning Commission will be of such size and character that it will be in harmony with the appropriate and orderly development of the B1 Neighborhood Business District. The location, size, intensity, and periods of operation of the proposed use is designed to eliminate any possible nuisance likely to emanate therefrom, which might be adverse to the occupants of any nearby permitted use. Excuse me. The proposed use is in accord with the spirit and purpose of the chapter and is not inconsistent with or contrary to the objective sought to be accomplished by this chapter and the principles of sound planning. The proposed uses of such character and vehicular traffic generated will not have an adverse effect or be detrimental to surrounding land uses or adjacent thoroughfares. Proposed uses of such character and intensity and arranged on the site so as to eliminate any adverse effects resulting from noise, dust, dirt, glare, odor, or fumes. Proposed use will not be adverse to the promotion of the health, safety, and welfare of the community. And the proposed use is designed and operated so as to provide security and safety to employees and the general public. That concludes this presentation.
Thank you. I'm looking for a motion.
This is Commissioner Willis.
Yes.
I would move a favorable recommendation for PS LU21-0009.
Port, Commissioner Huntington.
Okay, we've got a favorable recommendation by Commissioner Willis, supported by Commissioner Huntington. And we have a roll call vote, please.
Yes, sir. Mr. Huntington.
What?
Mr. Martin, are you on yet? I'm not seeing him yet. Okay. Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Support.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
Mr. Culpepper.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, you do have a favorable recommendation for PSLU 21-0009.
Okay, good luck. Thank you. Moving on to the next item is PSLU 21-0010.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So this is the second of our public hearings this evening. This is also a special land use. From petitioner Queen of Sheba LLC doing business as Taste of Ethiopia on behalf of the owner Promenade Property. The location 28639 Northwestern Highway, south side of Northwestern Highway between Franklin and Beck. Civil parcel 24182760 60. This property is also zoned B1 neighborhood business. And like the previous case, this is a special land use request to allow for the tenant space to be used as a restaurant with a bar. This is a closer view of the property in question. Again, you're in the Franklin Northwestern Highway area. The unit itself is closest to Northwestern Highway here on what would be the northeast portion of the building. As you can see, the property here, this is looking from the parking lot. So we're on the west side of the site looking east. So you do have the Taste of Ethiopia restaurant currently. And what they were looking to do would be to move into the space directly adjacent to them to increase their square footage. As I noted, property is zoned B1, neighborhood business. Regional mixed use is the future land use for the property. So this is the floor plan. You do have, again, the existing Taste of Ethiopia is here in this gray portion. They are looking to expand into the adjacent unit. You can see the layout for the tables as well as the bar for this particular location. With that, I do have a couple of members of the team for Taste of Ethiopia on this evening. So whoever would like to speak a little bit more on their project, give a little more background, now is your opportunity to do that.
And please state your name and address for the record at the beginning. Thank you.
I'm Danielle Cattaray. I am the architect for the project. My address is 2428 Galpin Avenue in Royal Oak, Michigan, 48073. So yes, as mentioned, my client has been operating out of the gray portion. She had an opportunity to take over the neighboring suite to expand her business. She already has a liquor license and there's already a cocktail menu. That's essentially the same. She just has more breathing room now and an actual proper space to mix the cocktails and keep all the products related instead of kind of squeezing that function into the kitchen area in a previous previous suite. I mean, that really sums it up. It's just kind of maintaining her existing service. She's not looking to create a nightclub or anything. It's just...
Yeah, if I may, Danielle, then similar question to the previous petitioner. Number of employees and hours of operation.
I think I'm going to have Mesky speak to the employees. I'm not certain. I believe the hours are 12 to 12, but I'm going to let her chime in here.
Hi, my name is Mascaram Gabrihanes. Can you hear me?
Yes,
we can.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, I'm not a new kid on the block for the business. I've been around in Southfield. I used to be on Southfield Plaza for 11 years, and then I relocated here on Northwestern Highway for the past 5 years. And right now I have about four full-time and two part-timers as an employee. And I'm hoping to double, if we find who's interested to work, double this number. And the operation hours will be Monday to Saturday from 11 to 12 midnight. So Sunday will be closed. For now, I'm closed also right now. So I'm hoping if business permits anything to open up for Sunday, but right now, Monday to Saturday.
Well, if I may, then if I mean, you want to keep your options open. So like with the previous project, you might want to modify your hours, at least get approved now for Monday through Sunday. You don't have to be open at those hours. You can stay open, you know, as you currently do Monday through Saturday. But to keep your options open, you might want to request Monday through Sunday now so you don't have to come back later on should you choose Sunday hours.
I'll take that. Definitely, I'll take that recommendation.
Okay, thank you. All right, this is a public hearing. We'll open up to you, the public, at this time.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So for again, for any public that might be listening or watching, this is your opportunity to make a comment on this particular special use. Again, your comment needs to be just regarding whether or not this particular location should have a bar or not. That is what's before the Planning Commission this evening. As I noted earlier, there's a little bit of a delay between the live Planning Commission portion of this meeting and what's shown online. So we will wait about a minute or so, give an opportunity for people to call in. Number 1-415-655-0001. And then when prompted, add the code 2345-816-8678. And Mr. Chairman, we'll wait about a minute or so and see if anyone calls in for comment on this particular item. And Mr. Chairman, I'm just going to ask the question here of those on the attendee list. Is there anyone who would like to make a comment regarding PSLU 21-0010, the request for a restaurant with bar for Taste of Ethiopia? Now is your opportunity. And Mr. Chairman, it appears that there's no one for public comment this evening.
Okay, we'll close the public hearing and open up to the commission for.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, just want to mention just a couple of things. Sure. There are some site issues on this property, some maintenance issues, some trash debris issues on site, as well as some repair needed for some curbs, dumpster enclosure, and fencing. I just want to bring that up to the commission that there are some site issues that do need some resolve on this property. And we will be noting that, at least I'll be noting that in conditions that those things do need to be taken a look at and need to be repaired. I know that we're just dealing with one particular tenant space here, and that may be something that the property owner themselves needs to resolve. But there are some maintenance issues that do need some resolve on the site. So I just want to bring that up right now.
Okay. Commissioners, any questions or comments?
Mr. Chair, this is Commissioner Culpepper.
Yes.
I guess this question is for Jeff. Jeff, at our last meeting, there was some question about the dual address. Realize that all she's doing is extending her property, but if my notes are correct, there were two addresses there, and I thought you were going to look into that. Is that, am I correct, and has that been resolved?
Yes, if I may, through the chair, to Mr. Culpepper and the rest of the commissioners, that was resolved. We did have a conversation with the property owner with regard to the address issue, and that is resolved, sir, so there's no issues with that.
Okay, thank you. My second question is, with the statement that you just made, Jeff, that issue doesn't primarily deal with her unit. Is that per the complex, or does she have to do something and you and Terry would look at it administratively before you bring it to the city council to make sure that's correct? How are you going to handle that in case it comes up at a city council meeting?
With regard to the maintenance issues that I noted?
Correct.
Yeah, so again, those are items that should be taken care of. Whether it's done through code enforcement going out and issuing a citation to the property owner, letting them know that they need to bring the property back up to the proper look, aesthetically, fix things that need repair. Again, we just wanted to note during this meeting that there are some site issues that need to be resolved. Again, whether it's through a code enforcement issue or through this particular location and with this tenant, it is something that needs to be resolved. I'm not sure if the city planner has any additional comment on that.
Yeah, this is Planner Crowe. I've just asked the tenant to reach out to the landlord and try to resolve those issues on your own before we have to send codes department out there. And I'm sure Mr. Spence can provide you with details of those things. These are typically routine maintenance issues that we always look at whenever there's new approvals. So hopefully you can get that resolved before it goes to council. But thank you for bringing it up, Commissioner.
Can I say something?
Yes.
Okay. Honestly, this is an ongoing issue with not only with me, with the whole tenant in the plaza. We've been trying to always, you know, addresses to have the front, even the back and everything to be maintained. I did give the items, the letter that was came recommended from, I believe with the landscaping department. I gave that the landlords. It's about three of them. So they really need to be forced to do this. I did always mentioning, like, it doesn't look good on appearance and, for a business. And the same thing with the dance studio or the Thai food. We've been bringing this issue, ongoing thing. So I really love if the city enforces this to be fixed and repaired.
Okay. Well, obviously, we want you to expand your business, but, you know, you do have leverage with paying your landlord and not telling you to withhold rent, but it's good to bring it to their attention at this time to get things done. Obviously helps your appearances, outward appearances as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Commissioners, any other comments?
This is Geraldine Stevens Gunn. I have a question for Jeff and Planner Crowe. Will the petitioner be penalized because of these violations or issues? I'm not understanding how that relates. Could you please help me out here?
Well, if I could, this is Planner Crowe. This is part of our routine inspections. We will decipher between what is maintenance issues and what is compliance issues. We hope that this can be amicably resolved without going to the codes department, because then the codes department will file a case and could end up in court. So if it's site maintenance issues, it's the responsibility of the landlord, then we will proceed. We won't hold up the tenant, but as the chair has said, this is good leverage to try to get it peacefully resolved without having to go through, you know, court action or fining anybody. So if it's an issue specific to the special land use, that I'll have to be complied with. If it's a site maintenance issue, then we will follow up with the codes department on that. And as I said, hopefully the tenant can reach out to the landlord and get it resolved before council. Otherwise, we will forward it to the codes department and have them officially cite the landlord. But we try not to do that if we can help it.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Hearing none, also in favor of this project, wish you luck. And can we have the planning recommendation, please?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So with regard to PSLU 21-0010, the special use request of Queen of Sheba LLC doing business as Taste of Ethiopia, the planning department does make a favorable recommendation to allow for a restaurant with a bar to be located in the tenant space, located at 28639 Northwestern Highway, civil parcel 24182760 on the south side of Northwestern Highway between 12 Mile Road and Beck, section 18 of the city of Southfield, for the following reasons and conditions. Hours of operation shall be limited to 12 noon through midnight, 12 midnight, Monday through Sunday. And again, the note, the change there from Monday through Saturday to Monday through Sunday, based on the comment that the petitioner had made earlier. These are the other items that I did note, that there's maintenance for existing landscape beds and the removal of trash and debris from the site, repair of broken curbs, dumpster enclosure, and fencing. Submitted special use with any conditions recommended by the planning department and the planning commission will be of such size and character that it will be in harmony with the appropriate and orderly development of the B1 neighborhood business district. Location, size, intensity, and periods of operation of the proposed use is designed to eliminate any possible nuisance likely to emanate therefrom, which might be adverse to occupants of nearby permitted uses. Proposed use is in accord with the spirit and purpose of the chapter and is not inconsistent with or contrary to the objectives sought to be accomplished by this chapter and the principles of sound planning. Proposed use is of such character and vehicular traffic generated will not have an adverse effect or be detrimental to the surrounding land uses or adjacent thoroughfares. Proposed use is of such character and intensity in a range on the site so as to eliminate any adverse effects resulting from noise, dust, dirt, glare, odor, fumes. Proposed use will not be adverse to the promotion of the health, safety, and welfare of the community, and the proposed use is designed and operated so as to provide security and safety to employees and the general public. That concludes this presentation.
Thank you. We have a motion.
To the chair, Commissioner Culpepper. I recommend favorable approval for PSLU 21-001 with the amendment to the days of the week operation from Monday through Sunday.
Commissioner Huntington, support.
Yeah, we've got a favorable recommendation by Commissioner Culpepper, supported by Commissioner Huntington. Can we have a roll call vote?
Yes, sir. Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Support.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
Mr. Culpepper.
Support.
Mr. Huntington.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, you do have a favorable recommendation for PSLU 21-0010 with the amendment to the hours of operation. 12 noon through 12 midnight, Monday through Sunday.
Okay, thank you and good luck.
Thank you.
Moving on, the next item is PSP 21-0009.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So we are now moving into the site plan portion. So just as a reminder, there are no public hearings on the next three items. These are just site plans only. The first one this evening is PSP 21-0009. Petitioner is Habitat for Humanity Oakland. And a property located 20436 Westland Drive on the north side of Westland, and we are just west of Evergreen Road. Civil parcel is 2434428-012. Existing zoning is RT, attached single family, and the site plan review request is for the construction of a 2,388 gross square foot residential duplex, single story. If you recall, last year, this particular property, as well as three properties on the south side of Westland, were rezoned to RT, attached single family. to allow for duplex type uses on the property. The first one that has come in is on the north side of Westland. So this is the property that's currently shown in red here on the map. There's a potential for the other three to come in later on, but currently the north property is the one that is being proposed this evening. This is a closer look at the property. Again, it is currently vacant. There are houses on either side, as well as houses directly to the north. Directly across the street are the other three lots that I just discussed that were also rezoned to RT attached single family. This is a proposal for the site plan. It does include the duplex units that would be basically centered on the property. They are also proposing two 10-foot by 10-foot sheds on the north side of the property, one single driveway that comes in off of Westland Drive. If you recall from our meeting from a couple of weeks ago on December 1st, there was a conversation had with regard to the requirement for a 5-foot concrete sidewalk. The petitioner is showing that concrete sidewalk across the frontage of Westland Drive as required. We also noted that there were a number of waivers that would be required for this particular site. Those waivers included waivers for side yard setbacks. Within this particular zoning district in RT, the requirement is 30 feet on the sides, 30 feet rear, and 30 feet front. The petitioner was at least able to meet the 30-foot front and rear yard setbacks. It's the side yards that they are extending a little bit beyond. As I noted, 30 feet is required, and they're showing 26 on both the east and the west side of the site. Therefore, we would be looking at waivers of 4-foot for the east side setback and 4-foot on the west side setback. Including because of the requirements for side yard setback, any structure has to meet that setback requirement. And thus, we also have these 10-foot sheds on the north. They are shown at the 10-foot setback, which means that each of the sheds would need a 20-foot setback waiver for each one of those. And we also have a waiver required for unit floor area. Based on the zoning ordinance, the requirement is 1,100 square feet per unit, and currently provided is 979 square feet per unit. Thus, there is a 242 square foot waiver for unit floor area, and that's 100. And I forget exactly the number, 171, I believe. Per unit of waiver. So again, there are some waivers that are required. Just keep in mind that with this particular new setup of residential on the properties, we are looking to provide some additional types of housing within the city. So the duplex, again, was one that the council did approve through the RT attached single family zoning district. From a landscape standpoint, they are showing proposed landscaping on the property. They do have to provide tree replacement for two trees. In lieu of a full irrigation system, we are asking that each one of the units have its own spigot, to encourage preservation of plant materials for watering of lawns and plant material. In addition, tree protection fencing is required to protect all trees that are to remain on the site. This is a rendering of the proposed unit. This is the front yard, so this would be looking from Westland looking north. More elevations. And then the actual floor plan showing a living area as well as three bedrooms. And so this is one unit, and that would be mirrored on the opposite side as well. And with that, I do know that Mr. Richardson is on this evening, as well as Mr. Milliken. If either one of you gentlemen would like to speak to this project, now is your opportunity to do that.
Excuse me. Yes, this is Scott Milliken, Habitat for Humanity, Oakland County. Just wanted to extend our gratitude for the meeting 2 weeks ago, and hope that the changes that we made were as reflected in your requirements. Hopefully it's to your satisfaction. We're eager to get started on this project in the spring. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Commissioners, any questions or comments?
Go ahead, Commissioner Huntington.
Okay. Yeah, I think this project serves the site very well. I think this project fits in good with the site plan review standards as far as environmental and interconnectivity as far as the sidewalks. There's no lighting issues or parking issues. So I think it fits in well. I think this is a good site for that project. Thank you.
To the chair, Commissioner Culpepper.
Yes.
Scott, as we talked last meeting, good work. Habitat does a lot of good work throughout the city. And I'm proud and glad you guys have chosen Southfield to do this. Question is just like I asked last week. Since this is in a residential neighborhood, have you reached out to the residents? Have you gotten any feedback? Do they know about this project? How has any reaction been from the residents that will be affected by this new project?
Yes, thank you for reminding me of that point. We did reach out to the residents. We excuse me. We do already know quite a many of them. In fact, some of them are purchased properties from us already. Additionally, we reached out to the longstanding residents, have sent out a mailer as well asking for any feedback to come directly to us so that we can start a conversation with them if they had any questions about the project.
Great. Good piece of work, because I think, as you know, that they may not speak out with us, but when the time comes for the city council, we just didn't want any residents to pop up and say this is first time they heard of it. No one reached out to them or anything. So great piece of business. Like Commissioner Huntington said, I think this fits well in that area. It's been vacant for so long, and it's a nice piece of work for people to want to change up on how they live. So I wish you a lot of luck and great job. Thank you, Chair.
Yeah, if I may, through the chair, just as a note, the planning department also sent out notices to all property owners within 350 feet of this site that this project was coming before the planning commission this month. There's been nothing official sent to us in either a telephone call any written correspondence sent to us. So again, we have provided opportunity to the residents to make comments in the form of writing back to us, and we have not gotten anything from them on this project.
To the chair, Mr. Culpepper again. Yeah, I appreciate that. And again, we know, the commissioners know, that your department does send out notices about this, but as you know as well as I do, there are times that people show up at the public hearing for the city council and speak about things that they didn't hear about, they didn't know it. So That's all I want to do is make sure the petitioner knows that he has touched base and people come forward. That's it. But both of us know that although you guys do a great job on communicating to the residents, they may not show up and do stuff for us, but history tells us a few of them have showed up at city council meeting complaining about they weren't appraised, they weren't given this. So I just wanted to bring that to Scott's attention, and Scott, you did a great job on that. Thank you.
Any other commissioners have comments?
This is Commissioner Willis. I just think it is the future of the city. That is an older area in the city. Rebuilding there is just absolutely necessary. So, you know, I am supportive of this this project.
Yeah, I think it's a shame that there's not more two family and four family and townhouse style projects in the city of Southfield. So I think this is a good start. I'm glad to see it. I think it's a really efficient design, and you talked about the energy efficiency features of this building, which I'm excited to see. I think it's good. It's good to get more housing variety types. We've talked about this many times. Affordable housing is one of those very difficult challenges because it's so expensive to build things to code and efficiently and new, and labor shortages and all the stuff we all deal with every day. It's a complete nightmare, but I'm glad to see this happening. And then I understand this meets the parking requirements. I just think that may be one of the shortcomings of this particular site plan in the, you know, in its current state. There's one space outside, one space inside, maybe two spaces in the driveway. So, I mean, as long as they're, it's a nice large site. So hopefully as people move into the house and feel comfortable improving their own property a little more, that could change in the future. But it does definitely meet the intent of the ordinance. And I think maybe we need to come up with a simpler zoning district than the attached family. Maybe there should be a duplex district that this could be a little simpler process moving forward. But this is a good project to keep this momentum moving on the housing variety.
If I could, through the chair?
Yes.
Mr. Planner Crowe, I just wanted to mention that I actually grew up in two families, but they were stacked. And we had one driveway for up to four, five cars. And especially in the upstate New York with a lot of snow, yes, there was some challenges with every car bumper to bumper in there. I think this is a better layout. And for the most part, you know, you work something out with your neighbor. So I grew up in a two-family stacked. My first house that I owned was a two-family stacked. And I think this is a good product, a good infill product in the city to offer some different types of housing choice. So I'm happy that we're moving forward. Thank you.
Absolutely. Can we have the recommendation from the planning department?
Hey, Mr. Chairman, yes. So with regard to PSP 21-0009, the site plan review request of Habitat for Humanity Oakland, the planning department does recommend favorable consideration of PSP 21-0009 for the construction of a 2,388 gross square foot residential duplex property located at 20436 Westland, Sidwell Parcel 2434, 428012 on the north side of Westland between Evergreen and Prescott. For the following reasons and conditions, Planning Commission finds that one family units of less than three attached units is reasonably necessary or convenient for the satisfactory and efficient development. It is necessary for the creation of effective density development and is necessary for the extension of the single family character in a single family residential area. Is subject to receipt of waivers from the Zoning Board of Appeals for the following: 4-foot waiver of east side yard setback per unit, 30 feet required, 26 proposed. 4-foot waiver west side yard setback per unit. 30 feet required, 26 feet proposed. 20-foot waiver of east side setback for shed, 30 feet required, 10 feet proposed. 20-foot waiver of west side setback for shed, 30 feet required, 10 feet proposed. 242 square foot waiver of unit floor area, 2,200 square feet required, 1,100 square feet per unit, 1,958 square feet provided, which is 979 square feet per unit. Landscaping must be installed in accordance with the approved landscape plan prior to issuance of a certificate of occupancy, unless the season of the year does not permit installation. In that instance, a bond must be submitted to the billing department to cover the cost of installation, and a temporary certificate of occupancy shall be given. Upon completion of landscaping and approval of the same by the planning department, the bond will be returned and a final certificate of occupancy shall be given. A $600 tree bond shall be provided to cover the cost of two replacement trees for the project. Tree protection fencing is required. Let me just give me a moment. Tree protection fencing is to be installed per the approved landscape plan. Fencing is to be inspected by the planning department prior to release of building permits for work proposed. Any exterior lighting will be shielded, prevent spillage of glare onto adjacent property. In lieu of a full irrigation system, the petitioners provide one outside water spigot per unit for all landscape areas to encourage preservation of plant material. Petitioners execute a perpetual maintenance agreement for the landscape and parking areas, both on site and in the right of way, which includes maintenance of any stormwater detention system. Petitioners implement the recommendations made by the Southfield Police Department's Crime Prevention Bureau regarding site security. In lieu of a required bike rack, the petitioner shall provide at least one bike hanger in the garage of each unit. Buildings are to be constructed in accordance with the submitted elevations. Per Article 4, Section 5.31, Paragraph 18, sidewalks not less than 5 feet in width shall be constructed 1 foot inside the right-of-way line for all abutting streets. And due to the nature of the development in keeping with the single-family character of the area, the way parking is situated on site in driveways and garages, 6-foot high masonry screen wall is not required adjacent to parking areas. That concludes this presentation.
Can I have a motion, please?
The chair, this is Commissioner Culpepper.
Yes.
I recommend favorable approval for PSP 21-0009.
This is Commissioner Willis. I support.
Yeah, we have a favorable motion by Commissioner Culpepper, supported by Commissioner Willis. We have a roll call vote.
Yes, Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Accept.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
Mr. Culpepper?
Support.
Mr. Huntington?
Support.
Mr. Martin, I do see your name on here. Are you available, sir, to vote on this particular item? You would have to unmute yourself.
He did say he was on through the phone, the chat.
Well, let me... Mr. Martin, are you available to speak on this item? I don't hear him.
Support.
There you are.
You get that, Jeff?
I do now, yes. All right. Thank you, sir. Mr. Griffith.
Support.
All right, so Mr. Chairman, you do have a favorable recommendation for PSP 21-0009.
Thank you. Good luck.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If I could, before you guys hang up, Scott, can you just make a note on your floor plan that you'll have the bike rack hanger, the garage?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
All right, next is PSP 210010.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So the next two items are site plans related to two of the parks here in the city of Southfield. The first one has to do with Miller Park, and the second one has to do with Sims Park. So I will do the presentation first on PSP 21-0010. So this is petitioner's OHM on behalf of the city of Southfield. So this is for Miller Park. That's located on the south side of Webster between Rambling and Southfield Road. Citadel parcel 2411-426025. And the site plan review request is for alterations to Miller Park, to include new pickleball and basketball courts, as well as asphalt trails around the existing ball fields, some landscape changes, as well as some changes to some existing parking on the particular property for barrier-free spaces. So this is an aerial photo of Miller Park. You can see it's in the red area there. The current layout of the property has two ball fields, as well as some tennis courts, basketball courts, and then a small play area, and then a parking area along Webster. This is a demolition plan that shows the demo of the basketball or the tennis courts here. And then this is the redo of that particular area, showing pickleball courts, what would be on the east side of the property or on the right, and then basketball courts on the left-hand side. In addition, there are some changes being made to the barrier-free spaces on the property. Bike racks are being installed, as well as trash receptacles and signage. In addition, there's a pathway, 10 foot wide, that is being proposed around the existing ball fields, as well as a connection, a smaller bit of sidewalk here, or pathway from the existing playground, which is to remain, that connects into that 10 foot pathway all the way around. With that, I do see there's at least one member of Parks and Recreation on, and I do see Chris Riggert, who I believe is with OHM, is on this evening as well. Chris, now would be your opportunity, or Nancy Keener, should you have any questions, comments, now is your opportunity to make those comments with regard to this project.
Jeff, before we go through the chair, we received one or two neighborhood mails or comments. Do you want to just read that so that Chris and Nancy can respond to those concerns?
Sure, I can read the letter that we received on December 13th. This is with regard to Miller Park alterations. It is dated December 5th, 2021. It says, to whom it may concern, as an adjacent property owner to the proposed expansion of Miller Park, located at Sidwell Parcel 2411-426025, we would like to express concern for noise and privacy issues after said improvement. We are entitled to quiet enjoyment, in parentheses, of our property at 29950 Rambling Road, and would like to know if you have planned for noise abatement or a taller privacy fence. We truly admire and appreciate the way Southfield government takes care of the city, and we thank you in advance. And this is signed James and Linda Morrison, 29950 Rambling Road, Southfield, Michigan, 48076. And that's the only letter that I have here.
Okay, so Chris or Nancy, just please try to respond to that issue as well as any other comments that the commission may have, but we'll turn it over to you if you want to add anything at this time.
Sure. Hi, Jeff and Terry. This is Terry Fields, Parks and Recreation Director. Nancy's listed because I was on the other computer. We had a Parks and Recreation Board meeting, so I kind of switched chairs and just finished. So good evening, commissioners. I'm here and I'm joined with Chris Riggert is on the call as well. First and foremost, we definitely heard some comments from some of our residents. Terry, you mentioned, and Jeff, the letter that was written about sound and privacy. I also talked to a couple of folks that were concerned about the path and the distance from the backyards to that walking path. I did not speak to the individuals that wrote the letter. I did speak to the folks that were concerned about the walking path and shared with them that the walking path is about 90 feet from the back of the fences. They were satisfied with that. What they did not want to see is a line of trees blocking their sight line into the park. They definitely know that folks will start to use the park and be active. Their concern was the having some sort of bumper block or bollards at the head of the path, the head of the trail there, that would keep folks from being able to have access. So spent a lot of time with her on the phone. She's very reasonable, very excited. Had more concerns, it seemed, with Home Depot. She is very aware of noise. When they have a third shift, she hears trucks coming in and out and loading. So she was sharing some of her thoughts there. But as far as our improvements for Miller Park, these improvements really reflect the feedback that we've received from previous master plans. As well as the current community engagement we've been involved with our current master plan work and the surveys. We know that, boy, outdoor space has really become of a priority, even more so than it ever has. And so we really want to be able to not only address those areas that have been, that haven't had the attention that we get phone calls all the time about being able to play basketball outside. So we're really trying to invest back into the park. The change that we have is bringing pickleball into this site as well. Those are folks that are adults. So we like to mix our residents and really have some peer pressure and some other sets of eyes out there. With that kind of presence. And walking paths have been a common theme, whether it's our surveys, whether it's conversations, whether it's work with Ascension and Beaumont, and always looking for safe places to walk. We really feel like this is our responsibility to improve and create spaces for healthy, safe recreation. We certainly will take into consideration the comments that have been shared with us to this point, and we will continue to have engagement. I don't know if Chris has anything that he would like to share at this time. Certainly would open it up to him as well if he's got something to share. Other than that, if there's something else that you would like us to address, Terry or Jeff or any of the commissioners, let us know.
I can add a few comments, Terry. Thank you, and thank you to the commission. It's a pleasure to appear before you again. In regards to the path distance, as we discussed last time, the path is about 90 feet from the fence line, and that is about as far into the park as we can move it and still maintain the existing baseball diamonds. They require an offset of 200 feet from home plate to the edge of the walkway, or to the outfield. So you can see the arc of the path is really tight to those limits so that we can maintain the ball field playability and introduce the walking path. It sounds like Director Fields was able to speak with some residents about the idea of some additional trees that may help provide some screening. It sounds like, you know, that is one option that was discussed, and maybe there's some direction there. So I report that from the Parks and Recreation Master Plan, of which a draft is available online right now, there's an overwhelming desire for walking trails throughout the community in Southfield. And so Parks and Recreation has done, I think, a great job of finding the beginnings of some opportunities to introduce those walking trails that folks are asking for. And I think, as we've talked with Terry, these are the first two, and hopefully there's more in the future. Thank you.
This is Planner Crowed, and I think between Ms. Fields and yourself, you've answered or responded to at least the concerns. I would just ask, prior to this going to council, you add that 90-foot dimension on there. And then if it makes sense to plant some trees, I know one neighbor has some concerns about site distance. And I said that we could help with our tree trust fund. Maybe just think about that. And if it makes sense, just show randomly, you know, where you would plant a few of those trees. But again, we want to be sensitive to the neighbor's concerns, which I think you're aware of and have addressed. So I have no other comments. So I'll turn it back to the Planning Commission. If I may, through the chair, I do know that there were a couple of things that were discussed on December 1st with related to the parking lot. And I think, Chris, you had talked about it last time, looking at the potential for bumper blocks in the parking lot. Because there were concerns about how the parking lot was being used, how vehicles were using that particular lot. And I think the other item had to do with the fence heights between the basketball courts and the pickleball court. They were shown at 5 feet, at 4 feet, and wondering if there might be some thought about raising some of the heights of those fences as well. So could you address those? Have those been talked about at all? Or research further?
Yes, sir. We, you know, maybe Director Fields wants to jump in as well, but I would anticipate that being able to put those parking blocks in will stop folks from drifting around the parking lot. You can see that there, even an aerial view, that there's lots of tire skid marks from where folks have been drifting. So putting in those blocks at the nose of the stalls will provide a barrier and should reduce that, and is a fairly straightforward component to implement. And you're correct, Mr. Spence, we did talk about increasing the height of the fence between the two courts to mitigate any conflict between basketball players and pickleball players, to raise that center fence from 4 foot height to 8 foot height. So unless Ms. Fields has other direction, I don't see any barriers to modifying the plans accordingly.
We did have conversation about raising that fence height. I don't know that we settled on 8 foot necessarily. We can certainly talk about that. Just wanted to bring to the attention of the commission to making sure that you knew that basketballs weren't being shot toward those courts. They're both on the ends and on the opposite side of the pickleball. So we will address the height of that fencing for sure. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioners, any other comments on this project?
Yeah, through the chair, Commissioner Huntington.
Yes.
Okay. I think Southfield, you know, wants to be known as a good city to raise a family in, and Parks and Recreation is important for that. I'm glad to see the basketball courts. I know a lot of cities are kind of afraid to put basketball courts in, but I think the layout, the plan is very good, very well thought out. I do have a question. Is this a park that can be, say, rented out or reserved for small functions or family reunions?
No, we're not currently reserving Miller Park for any kind of special event. We may program it in the future and look forward to that, maybe providing some pickleball lessons, offering some youth basketball programming. Certainly bringing our Recreation on the Move program there, but we do not currently rent that facility for family reunions.
Okay. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
to the chair, Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
I assume that since this is a neighborhood park, there are no provisions for barbecue pits or fires, that type of nature in the park?
There are no grills there. No, we've got junior baseball uses those fields. We've got some programs that are happening in the parking lot right now, but no, we don't have any grills there.
Will there be picnic tables?
We will take a look at some areas for resting spots, certainly. We definitely will see an increase of folks coming to the park, so we certainly will look at some of the site furnishings going forward.
Commissioner Martin, anything further?
I'm sorry, no, that was all. Thank you.
Okay.
Commissioner Griffin, this is Commissioner Culpepper. Two points. With the letter that came in about the noise, we talked about this last meeting, Terry. I'm quite sure you have signage up in that area for time the park closes. And also, if it gets to the point that kids are in the park playing ball after hours and making noise and disturbing the residents, that would be an issue that will be turned over to the police. So I think this is the same issue that came up last meeting of noise. And being a park, you know there's going to be noise, but I think after hours or after dark of closing hours at that park, the residents do have the right to have peace and quiet. So I think that's an easy resolve. The other question came up. Scott, you talked about having a fence between the pickleball court and the basketball court. Also, the issue came up with raising that fence, right, Jeff? Good call. Raising that fence on the outside of the basketball court, because as you know, you're going to have different talents or skill sets playing ball and shooting the ball at either end of those courts, whether you got the north or south or east court, those three courts, that fence there is. Because the balls go out in the parking lot, I think. So I think, I won't be 100% sure, but we talked about having that ball go over the goal out into the street or was a parking lot. So that may be able to be looked at, whether you go 6 feet or 8 feet. I know Terry has reservations about the 8 feet, which if you go 6 feet, but that has to be looked at also, because people will shoot, young kids will shoot the ball, and that ball may go over that fence, and that fence is 4 feet tall. That's not going to keep that ball from going out in the parking lot.
Absolutely. I think Chris was about to answer that too. We definitely talked about that perimeter fence being 8 foot.
Yes, and actually to that point, the standard for a tennis court is actually a 10-foot height fence, and we pulled down the fence height from 10 to 8 in order to provide better visibility, because when you get to a 10-foot height, you need a middle bar to support the fence. So you'll have a bottom bar, a middle bar, and a top bar. But coming down to 8, you only need the top and the bottom, which allows for better visibility into the courts. So it is an 8-foot height fence. And to your point, Commissioner Culpepper, I think you had mentioned that, you know, if a ball does go over the fence, that you have a little bit of a trek to go find the gate and get out. And I think it does make sense to probably find a way to shorten that route with maybe just a gap in the fencing to be able to get out and retrieve your ball if you're not, if you're an aspiring NBA player.
Yeah. Absolutely. Thanks, Chris. Thank you, Chair. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Any other commissioners? Nope. Hearing none. Looking for a recommendation from the planning department then?
Okay, thank you, sir. Just give me a moment here. So with regard to PSP 21-0010, the planning department does recommend favorable consideration of the site plan review request of Parks and Recreation Southfield Parks and Recreation for renovations to Miller Park, including new pickleball basketball courts, paving, barrier-free parking, an asphalt trail around existing ball fields, located Sidwell Parcel 24114260025, also known as Miller Park, on the south side of Webster between Rambling and Southfield Road for the following reasons and conditions. Landscaping must be installed in accordance with the approved landscape plan. Any dead, diseased, or damaged trees are to be removed. Any exterior lighting will be shielded to prevent spillage of glare onto adjacent property. Tree protection fencing is to be installed per the approved landscape plan. Fencing is to be inspected by the planning department prior to the release of building permits for work proposed. All elements of the site plan are to be installed in accordance with the approved plan. Proposed bike racks shall be securely anchored to the supporting surface and shall be at least 3 feet in height and shall support a locked bike in an upright position. Proposed site furnishings, i.e. benches and trash receptacles, shall be securely anchored to a supporting surface. Parks and Recreation Department will work with the city planner in choosing the types of furnishings. Use of bumper blocks will be investigated to determine if they should be installed in the parking lot. That concludes this presentation. Sorry for being tongue-tied there for a second.
This is Commissioner Rob Willis.
Just
curious, we did talk about fencing heights, and that was not included in the recommendation. I think where they are now is 4 feet. I know we're not going 10, but I would wonder if any consideration of adding at least a minimum height for fencing in the recommendation. I'm thinking 6 feet maybe as a minimum.
Well, it is up to the commission. I mean, if you think that height of fencing is something that you want included in the or other height. I mean, again, the site plan currently shows, if we're talking about the fencing between the pickleball court and the basketball court of a higher height, is that what you're talking about, sir?
That is correct. Between the pickleball court and the basketball court. And again, some numbers were discussed, and perhaps a minimum, and I would make that recommendation, perhaps a minimum 6 foot fence would be something that would make sure the, you know, the two activities wouldn't invade each other.
You have a suggestion, sir?
Again, 6 feet.
6 feet.
6 feet minimum.
And is this, I know we discussed this a lot, and I think part of it was me misreading the drawing in the beginning, which I shouldn't ever do because I should know how to read a drawing, but it's my left-handedness and seeing the arrow go from the other direction, I think. It's just a drafting conflict in my mind, but is that something we can just handle with between the planning department and the professionals here, or do we need to say it? Doesn't seem to be now that I understand what the intent was, it seems to make sense on the drawing. I know when we add fence height, you're adding dollars to this project too, and it's, I don't know how big of a deal it is.
I'm not sure what I have the base, just that it seems that a 4 foot fence between activities where balls are being slung around is just inadequate.
And I completely agreed with you on that. And I figure since you already have 8 foot fence around the perimeter, you don't put an 8 foot fence there.
Right. And so between the pickleball and the basketball court, again, by using a number like 6 feet as a minimum, if they need to go to 8 feet, if it's, you know, in their best interest to go to 8 feet, I would have no objection to it. It just seems like 6 feet, a little bit taller, about my height, would be about the right height to make sure, you know, you just kind of keep the space between the two. It's only 6 feet between the end of the basketball court and the fence, and another 6 feet between the pickleball court and that same fence, which just seems to be an awful short distance. And so, again, 4 feet just seems to be too short. 6 feet at least seems to be a minimum to me. And that would be my recommendation.
Ms. Fields, do you want to jump in here? We don't want to paint you in a corner.
Yeah, I understand the commission's concern, and it would be ours as well. You know, we had a 4-foot fence in there. We looked at a couple other parks that have kind of the same setup. I understand the commission's concern, but if you want to put a minimum of 6 on it, I suppose, but I really do want the aesthetics to be there, but I also want the logistics of play. And I think that we are responsible enough to be able to determine that. Certainly if this commission wants to put a 6-foot minimum on it, I understand, but we're all going for the same goal, and we can assure you that we'll make it an environment that both of the sports will be able to play and not impede on the other in within reason.
This is Geraldyn Stevens, gun to the chair.
Yes.
I'd like to say that I support the plan as it is written by the Parks and Recreation Department. I think that they have done the due diligence in order to identify the fencing and the level of fencing. I think that if in the future there is some issue arises, that they have the opportunity to make modifications. So I'd like to suggest that we move forward with as it is proposed.
This is Commissioner Willis.
Yes.
I will go along with that.
Okay. If one of you would like to turn that into a motion, that would be great.
Chicken Willis.
Chicken this is Willis. Commissioner Rob Willis. I would like to move for favorable approval with conditions outlined by the planner.
Support Commissioner Martin.
Stevens Gunn, I support.
Okay, we've got a favorable motion by Commissioner Willis, supported by Commissioner Martin. And can we have a roll call vote, please?
Yes, sir. Mr. Willis.
Support.
Mr. Culpepper.
Yes.
Mr. Huntington.
Support.
Mr. Martin.
Support.
Dr. Stevens Gunn.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, you have a favorable recommendation for PSP 21-0010.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to another park, PSP 21-0011.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So as I had noted earlier, this is the second park that is before the Planning Commission this evening, PSP 21-0011. This is Sims Park, which is located on the south side of, it's not Webster, I believe, I can't see at the moment, it's the north side of Wiltshire, between Glasgow and Pierce. So I apologize that there's some misinformation on the screen right now. But again, this is Sims Park. And the request is for alterations to the park that are similar to Miller for new pickleball, basketball courts, and asphalt path around the site. So this is a close-up of Sims Park. Again, you're on the north side of Wiltshire between Glasgow and Pierce. You can see the existing basketball courts and tennis court on the property, which is more on the Pierce side of the site. You have one ball field, which is down in the southwest corner, and then an existing playground, which is just north of the basketball and tennis courts. This is a demo plan for Sims Park. North, in this case, is going to your left. So again, with regard to the tennis courts and basketball courts, the tennis court actually be totally removed in lieu of new landscaping. And then the basketball court would be refurbished. And then you will see in a moment with the new plans that there'll be a new court that will be added directly, in this case, you know, underneath or to the south of the basketball courts. So here is the proposal for the renovations. As I noted, this will be a dual pickleball court slash tennis court on this particular location, and then a brand new basketball court with half court directly adjacent to that. You can see the proposed pathway that goes all the way around the site. Also includes some new landscaping off of the Pierce roadside, and then some new landscaping at the corner of Pierce and Wiltshire, excuse me, as well. New landscaping on the site as well as other site amenities. Excuse me. This is a close-up of the along Pierce Road for some new concrete, excuse me, as new landscaping, bike racks, and then some other site amenities. And then a close-up look at the that corner portion coming off of Pierce and Wiltshire, again with some brand new paving, trash receptacle, and some benches. It was noted at our last meeting on December 1st about the potential for placing a what would be like a pull-up parking space here along Pierce Road, and I will let Mr. Riggert talk about that particular item in a moment.
Yeah, I just want to jump in here, this Planner Crowe. I'm totally supportive of the fact that this is a walkable neighborhood park, but we did mention possibly having one barrier-free parallel parking space for drop-off and pickup be added to the Pierce Street entrance. So if you could address that. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Thanks, Jeff. Yeah, Sims Park is that walkable park. We did hear your comments about the drop-off area, and we are looking at that and taking that into consideration. I don't know if Chris has any details about that right now. I can share with you that we did receive a call from a gentleman, a resident, who's been there for quite some time. He did have some concern with us bringing basketball, outdoor basketball, back into the park. We did talk about some history. He was talking about 20 years ago and folks coming in and playing basketball, and he had some concerns about whether or not we were going to put lights in the park for nighttime basketball. I assured him we would not. He had some negative, this was about 20 years ago, some negative communications with some of our at the time, some of our parks folks that were not addressing some of his concerns. I talked to him for quite some time. We talked about the community engagement that our current police chief is involved with, and the involvement that he has in not only the presence at our events, but in presence at our parks. We talked about the accessibility into the park for everyone, talked about, you know, is I shared with him the comments that I received during COVID and the pandemic, especially at the height of it, that first summer when folks only felt safe outdoors, and we didn't have basketball backboards put in there. It just wasn't a playable surface. So I shared with him the amount of calls and the amount of input that we've had. He sort of acquiesced to it a little begrudgingly, but knows that, you know, kids have to have a place to play. Likes the walking path, likes the accessibility at one end of the at the opposite end there, down by the ball diamonds, being able to have access in We are going to improve signage there. We think it's a good idea, the drop-off area, especially for older adults or for folks that have some mobility issues. We'll have to take a look at that and look at the accessibility to the walking path and to the park itself. But yeah, we're definitely looking at that, at the drop-off area at Sims. I don't know, Chris, if you have anything else to add to that.
I do not.
Okay, thank you.
I don't, unless there's specific items that you're looking for me to address.
Okay, commissioners, any questions or comments on this part?
This is Commissioner Martin. I like the layout and the plan that's there, and I think it's good for the neighborhood. That's all.
I think this one looks good as well. Definitely like the idea of some parking space, if it's practical with the grades and everything. Any other commissioners have comments?
This is Geraldine Stevens-Gunn again.
Go ahead.
I agree with you. The only concern that I have is that, say, for example, you have some activities or some recreation in the park where you have people driving, there's going to be limited parking on the streets in front of people's homes. That might be a problem, but as was discussed at our last meeting, they're not anticipating that, but that is my only I guess you want to say a caution flag, because there is not a parking lot for people to use. So that's I'd say a yellow caution flag.
Okay, can we have the recommendation from the planning department?
Yes, sir. So with regard to PSP 21-0011 site plan review request for Sims Park, the planning department does recommend favorable consideration of the site plan review request for a new pickleball, basketball courts, landscaping, asphalt path around the existing site located at Sidwell Parcel 24131-34-005. 24132-06-006 on the north side of Wiltshire between Pierce and Glasgow in section 13 for the following reasons and conditions. Landscaping must be installed in accordance with the approved landscape plan. Any exterior lighting, should there be any, shall be shielded to prevent spillage of glare onto adjacent property. Tree protection fencing is to be installed per the approved landscape plan. Fencing is to be inspected by the planning department prior to the release of building permits for the proposed work. All elements of the site plan are to be installed in accordance with the approved plan. Proposed bike rack shall be securely anchored to the supporting surface and shall be at least 3 feet in height and be able to support a locked bike in an upright position. Proposed site furnishings, including benches and trash receptacles, shall be securely anchored to the supporting surface. Parks and Recreation Department shall work with the city planner in choosing the types of furnishings. And the Parks and Recreation Department shall research potential drop-off parking space on Pierce. That concludes this presentation.
This is Planner Crowed. I just want to clarify on item 7, we're looking for an ADA accessible drop-off and pick-up parking space. Just want to make sure that we clarify that for the record. Thank you.
If there's no further discussion, entertain a motion and be sure to add the clarification on the ADA parking space drop-off area.
To the chair?
Yes.
I recommend favorable approval for PSP 21-0011 with the addition of providing for the parking space for the ADA.
Support, Commissioner Huntington.
We've got a favorable recommendation by Commissioner Culpepper, supported by Commissioner Huntington. Can we have a roll call vote?
Yes, sir. Mr. Culpepper.
Yes.
Mr. Huntington.
Support.
Mr. Martin.
Support.
Dr. Stevens-Gunn.
Support.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
Well, Mr. Chairman, you do have a favorable recommendation with the amendment that the drop-off space be ADA drop-off and pickup. And you do have a favorable recommendation this evening for that item.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, commissioners.
Thank you all.
Right. Next, we have the approval of the minutes for November 10th and 17th.
To the chair, this is Commissioner Martin. I'd like to recommend approval of the minutes for November 10th and November 17th as provided. Thank you.
Mr. Culpepper, support.
Support.
Okay. Got a favorable recommendation, approval of the minutes by Commissioner Martin, supported by Commissioner Willis. Have a vote on the minutes, please. Roll call.
Yes, sir. Mr. Huntington.
Support.
Mr. Martin.
Support.
Dr. Stevens-Gunn.
Support.
Mr. Willis.
Support.
Mr. Culpepper.
Support.
And Mr. Griffiths.
Support.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, you have approval of your minutes for November 10th and for November 17th.
Hey, next public comment portion of the meeting.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So this is the portion of the Planning Commission meeting where the public has an opportunity to address the commission. The rules of procedure are as shown on the screen right now. In order to provide public comment, the telephone number is at the bottom of the slide. You need to call 1-415-655-0001. And when prompted, put in the access code 2345-816-8678. We do ask if you would like to make a public comment that you leave your name and your address for the record, and then you would have 3 minutes to make your comment. As I've noted earlier with our earlier public hearings, there's a little bit of a delay between the live Planning Commission meeting and what's shown on cable. So, Mr. Chairman, we will wait about a minute or so to see if anyone calls in for a public comment, and I will be back with you shortly. Okay, Mr. Chairman, I will just ask the question. Is there anyone currently on the line who would like to make a comment to the Planning Commission at this time? I ask that you give your name and your address for the record, and then you can proceed for 3 minutes. We have asked the question again. Do we have anyone who would like to make public comment at this time? And Mr. Chairman, it does not appear that we have anyone for public comment this evening.
Okay, public comments are closed. Any miscellaneous items?
I The only item that I currently have, sir, is just that your next meeting, as we go into January, your first meeting of 2022 would be January 12th. And we are looking at actually our first in-person meetings, which would be in the council chambers, and that'd be the first time that we met in person since March, I think February of 2020.
And if I could just add, we will be holding our study meetings and our regular meetings in the council chambers. It will be spread out at a greater distance on the dais, and we will be required to wear masks. So they're making some modifications in there to accommodate meetings moving forward. This is required based on the Open Meetings Act, and unless the state legislature, which they have shown no inclination of extending the COVID pandemic emergency to allow for virtual meeting, council and all boards and commissions will have to start meeting in person on in January. And the only exception is if member is serving in the military, they can continue to attend meeting remotely, but that is the only exception at this time.
Sounds good. I say good riddance to the roll call vote that we've been doing so many times. Can't wait to get everybody in the room.
The only other thing, I just want to again wish everybody a happy holidays and a safe and healthy new year. And I hope each of us can enjoy some time with family and friends over the next couple weeks.
Thank you. And the same to you and your family, Terry. And Jeff and whole commission.
Happy holiday to everyone.
Enjoy the holiday season.
Enjoy the holiday.
Thank you. I don't know if I can be heard, but happy holidays.
All right. Ken, sir, we hear you.
Meeting adjourned. Have a good one. See you in a few weeks.
Good night.
Bye. Bye.